Welcome. There we go. Hi, I'm Nancy Wilhelms, and I'm the Executive Director of Anderson Ranch Arts Center. And how many of you have attended a talk of Enrique's previously? Okay, great. And how many of you attended the one-day Saturday session last year? All right. Well, you know we're in for something special today, so hold on. All right, before we begin, I would like to thank in advance all of the staff and team members who make these presentations possible. So let's give them a round of applause. Our program today with Enrique Martinez Celaya is the Chairman's Choice Talk, and it's supported by the Chairman of our Board of Trustees, David Fuente, and his wife, Sheila. Yeah. And that's not Sheila next to Dave, right? Enrique Martinez Celaya is a longtime friend of Anderson Ranch. He's a revered faculty member. He's served on our board of trustees. And one of his ideas was the catalyst for our esteemed Advanced Mentored Studies program. He's an artist advisor to the ranch. And he is the author of a book that is very special to us. It's on art and mindfulness, Notes from the Anderson Ranch. If you're an artist, you want it. If you love art, you want it. Enrique was born in Cuba and raised in Spain and Puerto Rico. He initiated his formal training as an apprentice to a painter at the age of 12. And he developed what was to become an enduring interest in writing and philosophy in the thriving Puerto Rican cultural and political environment of the 1970s. Enrique began his career as a scientist. He received a Bachelor of Science in Applied Physics and a minor in Electrical Engineering from Cornell University, and a Master of Science with a specialization in quantum electronics from the University of California, Berkeley, where he was a Regents Fellow. He has published scientific papers on superconductivity and lasers. He's invented several patented laser devices and completed a significant part of his doctorate dissertation before abandoning physics for art. Then as an artist, he attended the Skowhegan School of Painting and Sculpture and received an MFA with the department's highest distinction from the University of California, Santa Barbara, where he was a junior fellow of the Interdisciplinary Humanities Center. Enrique is the author of books and papers in art, poetry, philosophy, and physics. And his work is held in public collections internationally, including the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, the Whitney Museum of American Art, the Moderna Museet in Stockholm, the Museum of Fine Arts in Houston, the Museum der Bildenden Künste in Leipzig, and the Wadsworth Athenaeum Museum of Art in Hartford. Other recognition and awards include the Roth Family Distinguished Visiting Scholar at Dartmouth College, the National Artist Award from the Anderson Ranch Arts Center, and the Young Talent Award from the Los Angeles County Museum of Art. Enrique is the first person to hold the Provost Professor of Humanities and Arts at the University of Southern California, and he is a Montgomery Fellow at Dartmouth College and a fellow of the Los Angeles Institute for the Humanities. Please welcome Enrique.
Thank you, Nancy. Thank you, Nancy, and thank you all for being here. I also would like to thank Alex and my children for being willing to endure another of these lectures. Today, I will speak about what I understand to be the disenchantment of our age. And I will offer some ways of being in the world as artists, but not just as artists, that might resist and could overcome this disenchantment. The talk has three parts. First, I will pose 20 of my own questions, and I will try to answer them. Then I will take your questions for about 10 minutes. Finally, I will close with a short video that is my favorite part of the talk, so I hope you can stay until the end. The talk is called The Artist, Conscience in the Age of Cynicism. But my concerns are not limited to the artist, and most of what I have to say relates to all of us, whether we're artists or not. Artists and not artists often complain about their situation. In their complaints, which are sometimes mine too, one senses their wish to be elsewhere, to have a different history or a different circumstance. This wish reminds me of that old story Alan Watts used to tell, where an American tourist in rural England asked a local how to get to an obscure village. The local scratched his head for a while, then said, "Well, sir, I know where it is, but if I were you, I wouldn't start from here." But unfortunately, this is where we are. So, what is it to be here? And why do I think ours is a cynical age? What are the choices we make? We celebrate the multiplicity of approaches at the Venice Biennale, the customized online experience, the many brands of cereal in the supermarket aisles, the opportunity to assert our individuality in the car of the genes we choose, or our democratic institutions. Our world seems to be one of choices. But when considered more closely, few of these choices are transformative, because at the deepest level, many of us prefer not to take the responsibility for our lives, which is what transformative choices demand. And without acceptance of this responsibility, we lose our moral compass and our convictions. Occasionally, we have the illusion of agency because we can customize our cell phone, but apps do not replace the connection we have lost with ourselves and with the world. We tend to treasure our whims because we see them as representative of our freedom, and we accept the confusion in our hearts and minds because we see them also as freedom, and sometimes as a sign of contemporary vitality. We rarely see a contradiction between seeking stability and wisdom in ancient texts or religion, while we struggle to keep up with trends reported by the New York Times. Or we miss the relationship between the cynicism and emptiness in much of the art exhibitions we see and our social, personal, and political conditions. Most of our hopes are superficial, borrowed, often distractions, and yet, surprisingly, we imagine ourselves masters of our destiny, captains of self-improvement, when in fact, many carry the burden of feeling lost or of being not enough. In the case of artists, superficial hopes tend to hide despair and confusion, and it is not hard to find deception and self-deception in the heart of many aspirational works. We carry on, but all too often out of habit or ego or of stubbornness. We carry on, but our world is not radiant. What is disenchantment? Frederick Schiller spoke of the disenchantment of the world more than 200 years ago. The loosing of myths that helped guide our lives in the past, the reduction of values to mostly those that can be financially measured, and our shrinking sphere of existence in a world of increasing global communication lead to our disillusionment, our disenchantment. Disillusionment and disenchantment make it difficult for us to maintain convictions. And when convictions are absent, rather than take principled moral actions, we tend to make choices guided by calculation, convenience, impulse, or fear. The price we pay for making choices this way is the clouding of the self, the fracturing of our connection with all that there is, and the loss of moral certitude. What is the or a role of capitalism in disenchantment. We live in a cynical time when commodities embody the sublimation of our desire for the presence of the divine, and where our daily experiences are defined by the transitory and the mediated. What I mean by cynical is the time when the prevailing thought is directed not to the ethics and value of how something comes about, but towards an end where motivations are understood as economic strategies aimed at maximizing profit. Almost everything has a mercantile exchange, including ideas. The dominance of markets in current thought is not an isolated condition, but depends on a system of support whose effect permeates society in general. In this environment, cynicism and materialism often overwhelm social and humanistic ideals. And wealth, especially immense wealth, becomes a symbol of authority and wisdom, and the divine lives in the markets. The Trappist monk Thomas Merton reminds us that when divinity lives in the markets, what has no price has no value, and what cannot be sold is not real. How does this enchantment evolve into narcissism? Let's think of Merton's words again. What has no price has no value, and what cannot be sold is not real. The self and interiority are hard to sell, so it becomes increasingly difficult for us to believe they are real things. Images, on the other hand, can be traded and sold. Therefore, we replace the cultivation of an authentic point of view and the development of the self with the glorification of the image. This cultivation of the image can be understood as narcissism, which offers an escape from the uncertainties of reality as well as the demands of authentic action. More than cultivation of the image, the narcissistic condition most of us experience is really an enslavement which replaces humility about what we actually know about reality with pretensions and false claims. This pretension is the antithesis of art. How has the art world responded to Marcus' disenchantment and narcissism? From Adorno, everything has value only if it can be exchanged, not insofar as it is something in itself. For consumers, the use value of art, its essence, is a fetish. And the fetish, the social valuation, which they mistake for the merits of works of art, becomes its only use value, the only quantity they enjoy. For the most part, the art world internalizes the spirit of the markets and its understanding of value. In fact, rather than resist or challenge the supremacy of markets, as it is sometimes claimed, the art world reflects and amplifies it. From time to time, we might hear artists complain about the situation, but few are really willing to break free from enslavement by the only system they know. Most of these complaints are ornamental, if not disingenuous, and our educational system is doing very little to offer alternatives. The prevailing ambiguity about the value of art beyond its dynamic as cultural production, and the difficulty of defining what it means to be an artist today, have led to educational institutions that are programmatically and emotionally disconnected from the subtle factors that shape an artist. In their disconnection, these schools fail to offer robust alternatives to a market-driven system. How did the Modern Project, which had such high aspirations, lead us here? The project of modernity separates the spheres of ethics, science, and aesthetics in the 18th century, which then in the mid-19th century leads to an increased autonomy of the aesthetic and to the consequent split between culture and society. This evolution also creates the cult of the new. Walter Benjamin writes, "Just as in the 17th century, it is allegory that becomes the canon of dialectical images. In the 19th century, it is novelty." Moreover, the success of modern scientific and technological rationality has rendered belief in pursuits such as art as quaint, if not silly. Jürgen Habermas writes, "With the decisive confinement of science, morality, and art to autonomous spheres separated from the life world, and administered by experts, what remains from the project of cultural modernity is only what we would have had if we were only to give up the project of modernity altogether. What happened to artists in the age of cynicism and disenchantment? The split between culture and the needs of the individual and the society has paved the way for the art's relative irrelevance in our world beside its commercial role. With our power of trust in the value of art beyond its commodity, its role as commodity, and with our aesthetics disconnected from the life world, it should not be surprising that many artists who are not successful in the markets feel like phonies or worthless or lost. Faced with this contemporary reality, the artist usually has two roads: develop a deep, authentic practice that perhaps cannot be traded, and thus he or she risks not existing, or develop an image that wedges itself into the spirit of the moment, and in this way risks losing him or herself. Maybe the choice is not always binary, but it is often binary, and in my experience, Many artists choose the second road by becoming versions of the entertainer, the impresario, the jester, the political commentator, or the reactionary maker of trinkets. Where superficially different, these roles share a basic disenchantment with art and a mistrust in its possibilities. In one of my workshops here last summer, I showed a video. It was an attempt to present what I have been speaking about so far. As over the top as the video seemed when it was first shown, it was hard to foresee the political and social evolution of the last few months. So before moving on to consider the options and possibilities for the artists today, and ultimately for all of us, I would like to show you an updated version of that video again as some sort of visual summary of what I have just said.
Welcome to the jungle.
Thank you. So where do we go from here? We're glued to our phones, concerned with the quick message, the ephemeral, the transitory, but we long to recapture something more permanent and more absolute. And yet, we engage in games of status, entertainment, and opportunism. These games sometimes distract us from our loneliness, and sometimes they give us the illusion of control. But there's no liberation in them. The freedom that is indispensable for human fulfillment will not be found in these games or in a customized lifestyle or in the enslavement of pretension. There are more possibilities for us, for art and for being an artist, than what you can see in this video. But where are these possibilities? What else is there in this age of disenchantment and cynicism? Could we relink culture with the life world? I would like to propose that art redirects itself away from the markets and towards life. That is, I want to relink culture with the life world. Simone Weil wrote, "We have forgotten the existence of a divine order of the universe, and we fail to see that labor, art, and science are only different ways of entering into contact with it. Divine, in my view, is not necessarily God, but an elemental, overflowing quality of what is. Art should move past its own confined sphere to become part of a broader inquiry allied with and responsive to life." I'm not suggesting we go back to an invented better time, a time of tradition, say. We cannot accept the falsity of being great again. I'm also not suggesting the answer is in the decadent anti-modern antics of the so-called postmodernity. There's no retreating from where we are. The right and the left, the intellectuals and the anti-intellectuals, the sophisticated art world and reactionaries, all share hostility towards the present, the authentic and the self. Disenchantment is nurtured by this rejection of the present. Change begins by being in the now. We must be vigilant of the presence of the world as is, however elusive, and we should demand art be the revelation of that world. What should artists concern themselves with present and presentness? Change begins by resisting the rejection of the present, including resisting the tendency to only exist in ideas or beliefs. Without praxis, there is no present. William James wrote in What Makes a Life Significant in 1900, "Our attitude should be wrapped with satisfied attention to the mere spectacle of the world's presence." Reenchantment and the overcoming of despair, the despair of narcissism, depends on this enrapture. The poet Kenneth Rexroth wrote in 1955, "The function of the artist is the revelation of reality in process, permanence in change, the place of value in a world of facts. His duty is to keep open the channels of contemplation and to discover new ones. His role is purely revelatory. The revelation the real artist brings forth is the future, an age of conscience where art is an inquiry not solely into aesthetics, but also, and much more importantly, into the foundation of what is. This inquiry shows the way." So now I would like to ask, can art still have the prophetic function assumed by the avant-garde of the 19th and 20th century? Or has it been irrevocably absorbed by the system I suggested in the video? Does the age need the genius to get to that prophetic function of art and beyond our cynical and disenchanted condition? We love geniuses. The art world loves to coin geniuses. We love them because they fit our image of the spectacular. Geniuses bring about the new, the unexpected. Proponents of reason want geniuses who understand the theories and the rules, both explicit and implicit, and who can surprise us with novelty. The genius transcends ordinary human knowledge without the metaphysical baggage that comes with the mystic. And in this spiritually uncomplicated gift, and this spiritually uncomplicated gift is appealing in a secular, pragmatic age. Yet, as it pertains to the art, the baggage is necessary. The experience of art cannot avoid mysticism. The age does not need novelty or more products. What it needs are a moral compass and an expanded emotional ambition. The genius is not what the age needs. If not a genius, should we hope for a mystic? Those who reject the art world often retreat to the idea of themselves as mystics. Maybe they don't call themselves that, but mystic is often the right name for the reactionary one finds, arguing for the past and for charming hiding places. While there's inherent mysticism in the arts, mystics are not what we need. Mystics engage with the divine or transcendental as an end in itself, and often as a way to abandon life. If not geniuses or mystics, who do we need? What the age needs are prophets. The prophet, unlike the mystic, returns to the world. The prophet stands firmly on the present, or he or she helps bring about the future. The prophet shows, even if in a world of blindness, we have grown suspicion of the gaze. The prophet struggles because he or she is not a genius. The prophet is aware the abandonment of life is not possible, but rather the life world is both framework and duty. The prophet is humble about his or her capabilities, but ambitious about what can be reached. So the prophet fails often, but the prophet does not let disenchantment creep in. Every fall clarifies his or her resolve. Allama Iqbal, the Persian philosopher and poet, wrote, "The prophet's return is creative. He returns to insert himself into the sweep of time with a view to control the forces of history and thereby creates a fresh world of ideals. A prophet may be defined as a type of mystic consciousness in which unitary experience tends to overflow its boundaries and seeks opportunities of redirecting or refashioning the force of collective life." In his 1911 triangular description of the life of the spirit, Vasily Kandinsky wrote, "Where the apex was today, the second segment is tomorrow. What today can be understood only by the apex and to the rest of the triangle is an incomprehensible gibberish, forms tomorrow the true thought and feeling of the second segment. In every segment of the triangle are artists, each of them who can see beyond the limits of his segment is a prophet to those about him and helps the advance of the obstinate whole." What are the essential qualities of a prophet? What Kierkegaard, Dostoevsky, and most other prophets have in common is a heightened sensitivity to the unfolding human spirit as manifested in the attitudes and morals that lurk beneath the surface of the moment. They also share urgency. Prophets are not inclined to wait for the right time. Their prophetic vision demands action, leaving little room for calculation and diplomacy. Truth for the prophets is not merely a belief, but a moral imperative that compels them to speak and to act with little regard for convenience or gains. But prophets need to do more than speak than act, and it is not enough to be apocalyptic. Prophets must be brought forward. Truth suggests our place in the world, and it is that place as well as the awareness of emotional, particularly floating in the atmosphere of the world, that the prophet artist brings forward. The notion that our age needs prophets seem anachronistic at a time when we think technology and governments will save us. So I'm probably asking too much of artists, or of anyone for that matter. It is likely we'll break our backs trying to be artist prophets. But isn't this a better fate than letting our backs calcify from being hunched over in shame? It is not hard to find reasons to laugh at what I'm saying. I know the arguments. Cynicism comes easy to us, especially when we think of the images in that video and trying to imagine those people as prophets. But that art, most art is decidedly insignificant in a world of calamities and beauty, does not mean all art is insignificant. These calamities and this beauty establish a benchmark, and artists should aim their work towards it. The proper reaction to the insignificance of most art in relation to the great tragedies and wonders of the world is not cynicism, but love and devotion. The failure is not in art, but in how many people approach art. Shouldn't we leave the role of prophets to religious people? I understand why these ideas will make us nervous. And yet, our best artists, artists in the broadest sense, have always been able to recognize the brewing future. To become an artist prophet, what is needed is not God or talent or vision, but attention to the present and desperation. Being an artist prophet is not a place to stand or a title. It is a way of being in the world. Most artists will not be great prophets, but even minor ones will make a difference. Maybe they will make a difference in the arts, but certainly, and more importantly, in themselves and in the world. I hear you arguing for heroes or maybe saints. Is that right? The artist prophet that interests me is not a hero, but someone whose ethical scrutiny demands a recognition of moral failings in him or herself before recognizing them in anyone else. This artist prophet, like Kierkegaard's martyr, is defined by his devotion, and unlike a saint who is in certitude at all times, the prophets must search for clarity in each engagement. Also, to be a prophet, an artist doesn't need God, but clarity of purpose, character, and attention. Spiritual superficiality and shamanistic delusions are not what I'm suggesting. Dancing in the forest wearing wolf masks or looking up at a gap in the ceiling does not replace purpose and attention. And no talent can take the place of character and desperation. Joseph Beuys, Herman Melville, and Albert Pinkham Ryder were prophets not because they sat around theorizing, but because they showed us something of the future and of ourselves. Again, our lack of talent and smallness of character are not in themselves reason to shy away from the calling. The prophet becomes a prophet through his or her work. Doubt of whether or not we are cut out for the task is a great motivator and a constant source of encouragement. What is the way towards the prophet? The initial impulse is the hardest. This is the impulse in which we demand from ourselves a desperate response to the present and to the presence of the world. What I'm suggesting we're after depends on a restless, impatient, continuing, hopeful, and desperate inquiry of the present moment. Our attitude should be one of attention to the presence of what is. Our capacity to act well relies on our capacity to see what is really there. In this inquiry, authenticity is key. The prophet must not pretend. We each must find the courage to be where we are and to work from there towards something bigger than what we might have considered possible. Staying the course sometimes will be hard. Find beacons to guide you, and often the best beacons are the lives and works of those who you admire, many of whom are dead. For the prophet, like for most of us, vigilance is key. Thomas Merton warned, "The false prophet will accept any answer, provided that it is his own, provided that it's not the answer of the herd." The sheep mentality, on the other hand, accepts any answer that circulates in his own flock, provided that it is not the answer of a prophet who has not been dead for at least 500 years. The honest position lies somewhere in between. This in between is hard to maintain, as our tendency is usually one of extremes. What can the artist prophet expect from his or her life? The life of an artist prophet is full of opportunity and discovery, but the many unknowns and the lack of models or conventions will mean you will face danger and deal with your own fears as well as with the fears of others. Often the greater fear artists face is the fear of our own inadequacy, which makes us feel we're only pretending to be artists. This fear might make you quit, or it might make you intensify the pretension, and neither of these responses is good. The best response is to recognize that, like your materials, fears are part of an artist's life, and you must learn to work with them. The artist prophet uses fear to fuel his or her resolve. Navigating a career is not easy, especially when you're not pretending. Expect to be thrown about by rejections, indignities, and by your own ambitions. You'll be challenged by the sacrifices you and those around you have to make, and you're likely to be battered by the uncertainty of whether the sacrifices are worth the potential rewards. The success of others will make you anxious, and the effervescence of art fairs, rankings, superstars, and money will be tempting. The wind of confusion will always be blowing against you, and monsters of one sort or another, like poverty or disillusionment, wait to ambush you around the corner. You will have to contend with your own doubts and limitations, as well as the loneliness that comes with setting yourself up on the artist's course in the first place. To keep at it with dignity and without bitterness, find examples that guide you and meanings that sustain you. So how can art be part of our attention to the presence of what is? Art is not an activity. One could be making paintings with art nowhere in sight. It's mirroring paint to make a portrait or a revisionist painting of George Washington, or creating a clever installation, or moving around a lump of clay can be death, regardless of how life affirming the cause or the politics. There are many byproducts of art activities, but art itself is rare. Many people decide they want to be involved in the arts, but what does this desire mean? What does it say about our understanding of art? Consider these questions from another point of view. Who says, I want to be involved in religions, other than a theologian or sociologist? Believers are not involved in religions, but rather they're involved in and with a specific worldviews and positions. To say I want to be involved in the arts is mostly to confess an affectation and a lifestyle choice. I often speak to young people who want to work in galleries. Usually they don't mean this gallery with this view or for this dealer with this or that conviction. I know collectors who like the arts and who like going to fairs and who like supporting museums. But seeing their collections, I wonder what some of them stand for. What is their imperative? How urgent is it? Should we assume a disparate collection of well-known names is a point of view or a need? Art activities, like art engagements, can become a lifestyle. Art, however, is a way of being in the world. Art is that attention that shows what is lasting in the ephemeral and the ephemeral in what is lasting. Art is awareness of an elemental order of what is, and this awareness unconceals truth. This awareness guides choices and illuminates the spiritual and emotional trends that will not become apparent to the newscasters for years, maybe for decades or for centuries. In the fullness of a great work of art, we find ourselves and our yearning, and we can sense the future rumbling under our feet. This sensing of the future opens possibilities beyond the cynicism and disenchantment of the moment. I waited a long time to ever answer this question publicly. So now you get to see me fumble through it. Tolstoy believed sincerity of emotion propels great works of art. At first, it seemed like a naive posture, if one would dare call Tolstoy naive. But he's right. There are many thoughtful, interesting, sensitive, or smart artistic activities. But without feeling, they are not art. But feeling is not all. It is a necessary but not a sufficient condition of art. The value of art rests on something I would call power, which is related to, but it is not the same as, feeling. I don't mean power as in a social process. Power, as I'm thinking of it, is being possessed by the recognition of the fullness of things, of the elemental order of what is. It is not merely recognition. It is rather an overfilling of recognition. The real artist's task is to be a vehicle for this overfilling. This overfilling is in rapture and reverence with what is. We don't want just a portrait. There are many of those already. We don't want an artistic portrait. There are many of those already too. We don't want the smart or the well-painted one or the one with the political message. We want the one that is overfilled. Let me be clear. We don't want the portrait that represents or points to enrapture and reverence. We want the one that is enrapture and reverence. The possibility of art depends on this enrapture, and the fulfillment of this possibility depends on love. Not love as something we're capable of, but love as something we can reveal in and through the work of art. A great work of art cannot come from cynicism or disenchantment. At the heart of great art, one finds love and compassion. Great art is a result of internal toughness. The undercurrent of softness one feels in many works is related to insufficient love. Insufficient love cannot be compensated with knowledge, complexity, rigor, cleverness, humor, virtuosity, or irony. Before moving to the final part of this talk, which is a short video, and as I said before, my favorite part of this engagement, I would like to stop here for 10 minutes and take your questions, and then return back. And I hope most of you, if not all, can stay. So maybe we can bring the lights up for one moment. Yeah, so if you raise your hand, they will bring the microphone to you. And any questions? Over here.
Thank you, that was really beautiful. It seems that we perceive art in terms of aesthetics, and the maker of objects is the artist. And we tend to favor aesthetics in that realm instead of function. But what if every person on the planet was an artist? And we were all crafting human experience, because that's what the maker of objects does, really, for himself and for others. But the distinction of artist is reserved for the maker of objects, and in particular, the maker of objects with some value in society, monetarily. But what if everyone was an artist, and that responsibility was clear?
I mean, there are people who make the argument, like Joseph Beuys, that at a fundamental level, everyone is an artist, whether they are denying it or not. I do not believe that. I mean, my brother is an eye surgeon, and I'm glad he's that, especially when I have an eye problem. I think that an artist is a way of being in the world, and there are other ways of being in the world. And I think that the problem is that that division of the spheres of aesthetics, ethics, and theology, science, have all, as part of the Enlightenment, separated into themselves. And artists were left here in this sort of polyp of knowledge, dangling out there in its own satellite, self-referential, self-contained, with no influence to the larger movement of ideas in a significant way, despite whatever claims sometimes are made by museum people. There's really an absence of engagement with other fields. I mean, only art people imagine that some scientific-looking art is influential to science. No scientists think that. Art has very little to do with ethics. In fact, we don't even understand ethics in art other than content in the work. When we mention the word of ethics and art, people imagine we mean that the content in our work is ethical, as opposed to the work itself is ethical. So art has been left to become really partly a commodity, but also partly a self-referential discourse. with the, every once in a while there's a slight crack and something comes in from linguistics or something comes in from other fields. But I mean, I don't know if this is the proper answer to your question, but I do not believe that everyone should be an artist, nor do I believe that artists are a special breed in terms of a hierarchy. They're just a certain kind of engagement with the world. As the Dalai Lama is a certain kind of engagement, as a doctor is a kind of engagement, as a gardener is a kind of engagement. And I do not ever feel compelled to bring the gardener into the gallery to find that there's value in gardening. For the same reason, I don't feel compelled to take the painting into the garden to find out it has value either.
But ultimately, the gardener is also crafting human experience, just as the artist does.
Well, the garden does not craft human experience. The gardener, the human experience, experience is a certain encounter with a certain condition. And one could create circumstances to sort of try to generate a certain kind of experience, but one doesn't craft experience. One just prepares the conditions for an experience to occur. And even though that sounds like a slight difference, it's a big difference. And it's certainly a big difference when artists think of what they're doing. And to the extent that artists imagine that they are crafting the experiences for others, they're missing the point of what experience is. You can't craft it for anyone else. People have to have it on their own.
In this age of the individual and the emphasis on diversification, how are we to find the gate to oneness? As we can do it for ourselves through various practices, but to have a social identity that a prophet would be part of. I mean, my experience over the years is they killed prophets, as they mean, prophets do not last long. Do you have in your philosophy and your understanding some path that a social path that we could take to re-engage in a unity of understanding among all creatures?
In the recognition of the present and the world as is, what immediately happens with that is that the self-absorption that is so typical of our moment sort of dissolves, because you cannot be simultaneously self-absorbed and awareness of what is around you, and be present to the world. When you're present to the world, the other, something outside of yourself, immediately emerges. The continuity between you and other things is immediately revealed.
That's fine for the individual, but what about society?
Well, that is why I'm not a politician. I think that many of our social problems is actually quite beginning on the individual problems. The self-absorption, cynicism, narcissism that we live creates certain social conditions, but everybody's in their little silos, disconnected from anyone else. I think you can imagine a condition in which people are more present to someone else's suffering, more present with someone else's expectations and loneliness and desires and so on, to the point that separation that we feel constantly and we read about in the news dissolves. I mean, if you imagine a society with people have a less isolated sense of themselves, some of the social desires you're speaking about, the larger social movements, will become easier to accomplish than it is when people are self-absorbed, self-preoccupied, and what the closest thing we talk about this is self-improvement, which is another self-preoccupied concern. Let's take one more question. Right here.
At a moment in time, you were on the cutting edge of quantum physics and and laser science. We're today at a moment in time when the advancement in science is more rapid than it's ever been. How do you see art and the rapid change of science interacting?
It's a good question. So, I mean, there are a couple different things I would like to say about that as a form of answer. The triumph of science in the last 200 years have made it so that the humanities, particularly at the university level, the humanities and the arts are playing catch up or a very insecure game. So this is true of deans, of individual faculty. It is reflected in the kind of policies universities make. And it's also reflected in the kinds of attempts that the art world have made to gain some validation. A lot of our writers and critics that fill the journals of the art world try to write as if they were scientists. You know, they have a very arcane language. Everybody, you know, you go to a convention of the College Art Association, and everybody is so robust and rigorous, from the look to the glasses. The whole thing is very scientific looking. Because the idea is the biggest fear in a lot of contemporary art is to come across as soft. And scientists and science is hard as it gets. So any detouring from that will reveal that maybe, you know, you're just not tough enough. You're sentimental. This kind of dangers of the art world. So you will do whatever you can, including writing something is senseless, that makes no sense, just to make sure that you seem knowledgeable. And when you're insecure, and many artists, then graduate students, when you deal with them, we talk to graduate students, you encounter that they're completely confused. But instead of revealing or acknowledging their confusion, which is perhaps the only place from which they can improve and they can get farther, instead of being where they are, they camouflage their confusion with some pseudo theory that they have learned a few things. None of them have really a philosophy background, but nonetheless, they quote it. And part of that is that same scientific prop, scientific nostalgia that I think the humanities and the arts feel. And you know, it continues on through the curatorial choices made by institutions and so on. The arts have profound things to offer, especially to our moment, that you know better than I do. I mean, and historically we have had people like Dostoevsky, for instance, revealed a certain moment as it was and give us back a reflection to ourselves of who we were at a certain moment in time. Or you have had, you know, artists like Velázquez reflecting Spain back to itself at a moment that Spain is collapsing and closing itself to the world after 1588. I mean, this is what artists and writers have always done. And we need no apology for what arts do. We don't need to prop ourselves on anything, and certainly not on science. Science is an incredible way of engaging the world. But that does not mean that there is no room for art, because ultimately, our humanity, our condition, our human condition, are best addressed and best touched by art, really, and best addressed by it, best revealed by it, and the truth that comes with it. So there's maybe never a more urgent time than now. One can say this at many moments in history, and maybe there's not a more urgent time, but certainly this is one of those moments that it seems that the possibilities offered by Boris Pasternak, for instance, are desperately needed. So with that, let's bring down the lights and finish the last 4 minutes of this. And then you can go to that beautiful sun out there. So before moving I am aware that what I'm saying is elusive, even this question and answer. Not because it is difficult to understand, but maybe because it is difficult to believe or to imagine how to implement it. So I thought we might need some examples of what profits might be. Examples keep us in check. Examples that strengthen our resolve. And I find examples to be clarifying in the confusion of the art world and the questions that come up in my life and in my studio. You and I will have different people who guide us, or of those we consider prophets. Today, I would like to end this talk with my examples. My life and my studio will not make sense without them.
Slashed and torn.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Enrique. This is wonderful. Thank you so much. Bob Dylan.